That'll do.
Got it?
I don't know. Can you hear me?
It's coming up, yeah. Yeah, it looks like it's working fine.
Man, this menu screen's starting to give me a headache. It's too early in the morning to be epic like this. I hear The Rock can't fight anyone until he's had breakfast and then a nap.
Yeah, he needs pie. The Rock runs on pie.
Is that true? I've done this thing, I'm going to put the microphone right in front of my fucking notes. I have to read the notes at an angle. This is just in shambles. It's falling apart already.
Press play in 3, 2, 1. Now.
And hello, and welcome to the jungle or the rundown commentary, depending on where you're from. I'm Neil.
I'm Guy.
And rocking straight in with a bit of trivia here. These two logos, the Columbia logo and the Universal logo, were the other way around in America, which basically because of the distribution deals and stuff that went down. So when it came to the international releases outside of the US, they had to change the entire first reel, essentially to swap these two around and to change the title, because in every country other than America, this is known as Welcome to the Jungle. In America, The Rundown. Guy, take it away with the numbers.
Panic. What do you reckon is a better name, The Rundown or Welcome to the Jungle?
I think The Rundown is actually a better name.
Yeah.
I there's nothing wrong with it as a title. Yeah. I don't quite
And he actually
get...
does run him down.
Yeah, and it's about a rundown. I don't get the reason why they had to change it. It's not a conflicting with any other franchise or anything that I'm aware of. I don't know, seems strange, but whatever.
Right, okay, so The Rundown, Welcome to the Jungle. I'm just going to call it Welcome to the Jungle because that's what it was released like under over here in the UK. So, directed by Peter Berg, produced by Mark Abraham, Bill Corliss, Karen Glasser, and Kevin Misher. Screenplay by R.J. Stewart and James Vanderbilt. Story by R.J. Stewart. Starring all the people that are in the film. Music by Harry Gregson-Williams. Do you know what music track this is?
This is Black Eyed Peas. Can't remember the name of the track.
Yeah, that's it.
That's all I'm going to give Black Eyed Peas. I don't care.
Okay.
I was in charge of soundtrack, and then I decided I couldn't give a fuck. So I'm not really going to bother.
Fair enough. Right, so yeah, edited by Richard Pearson. Cinematography by Tobias A. Schleisler. Even distributed by Universal Pictures in North America and Japan, and international by Columbia Pictures, as Neil said. Released on 26th of September 2003, and yeah, budget $85 million. Unfortunately, the box office was only $80 million.
Yes, didn't really do too well.
What was that weird rocket that shot up there?
That was him. Displaying his ability to throw a ball.
Right, okay. Right. So, yeah, like I said, the premiere was 22nd of September 2003. That was at Universal City in California. And then wide release in Canada and the USA on the 26th of September. Are we still listening to the Black Eyed Peas here? Or has this changed?
Yeah,
this scene has a lot of music.
I'm pulling up the soundtrack.
The music has a lot of changes in this scene.
In this scene alone, yeah, and it's really difficult to determine what tracks are playing where because people don't seem to know. The Black Eyed Peas track is The Boogie That Be.
Okay. Don't we just love Dwayne Johnson? He is just so good. Amazing. He's still known as The Rock in this one, though, isn't he? As opposed to
still goes as The Rock. He was still performing as The Rock at this stage.
He's still doing wrestling?
Switched to Dwayne Johnson, yeah, in 2004 he officially retired the first time.
So basically
time
after he blew up, you know... became big. So
then
after
it became Dwayne The Rock Johnson for a while, and then just known as Dwayne Johnson later on.
Very smooth transition. Cool. Right, yeah, so other places got it all over the time. We got it quite a lot later. We got it on 26th of March 2004, same time as Ireland. Bahrain got it on the 1st of February 2004. They got this film.
The song that's playing now is Freedom Band by Delinquent Habits.
Delinquent Habits. Never heard of them. Have you got...
They're a rap band. I've got the track is on our soundtrack that we created.
Let's see. Estonia got Welcome to the Jungle on 23rd of January 2004. Who else got it? Israel, 23rd of October 2003. Last people to get it. Japan, 29th of May 2004. And the video premiere, if anyone's interested, in Argentina, was 8th of June 2004. So there we go. So yeah, there we go.
The track that's playing now, nobody seems to know what the fuck it is.
Is this the one?
Can't for the life of me work out what it is. No one seems to know. Everyone keeps attributing it to either the run that, which plays at the end, which this isn't.
No.
Or they attribute it to the Missy Elliott track, which it isn't either. So, fuck knows what that is.
Hmm. See, this is sort of like the calm before the storm, and you know The Rock is just going to go fucking kick some ass.
The difference being, though, that he doesn't want to because he's a big sports fan. He's like, no, the entire defensive line is here. I don't want to beat these guys up.
Yeah. Do we know who plays this guy on the right?
No.
It looks...
Does look familiar. He's probably been in a bunch of stuff.
But... It looks a lot like the director, but... And I know the director, Peter Burke, has a lot of cameras in his stuff, but he wasn't credited as being in this film. Very similar look to him, though.
So too skinny to be the director.
Yeah, he
looks familiar to me, but I don't know who he is.
It's the moment of realization. Business face.
So this is a mashup of Get Your Freak On by Missy Elliott and AC/DC's Back in Black. Is it Back in Black?
Yeah. I think it sounds like it. Yeah. I'll take B. Ooh.
Usually credited, it's only credited as being Get Your Freak On by Missy Elliott, but it is a mashup. It's not the original mix.
Now this is sort of where we start getting the sort of action. Oh, fucking all the fight scenes in this film are just brilliant.
They're well thought out. I mean, this is like right in the wake of sort of Matrix world, where everyone was sort of doing kung fu and
stuff. But this sort of
things
does
like
it...
that. But this. It's got a unique sort of feel to the fight sequences, and that the movie just pulled off there is very similar to The Rock's finisher move, the Rock Bottom.
All right, okay.
But it's not exactly the same because Beck essentially stays partially stood up, or he's kneeling when he delivers it. It's where the Rock Bottom, you actually completely land flat on the canvas. So
yeah,
it's a different move.
Well, Andy Cheng, who did the fight choreography work on The Scorpion King, he worked with The Rock. He was sort of a good choice. The reason they sort of picked him is... I love this with the fucking tape. The vinyl deck.
Yeah, a lot of this sequence... Peter Berg was watching Snatch, apparently.
Oh,
the
really?
Film, not the object of lust. and he was sort of inspired by...
The object of lust!
He was sort of influenced by all the still frames and stuff like that that the editors used and stuff like that in Snatch to sort of incorporate that into this. And it's also the idea he got for introducing the characters in this sort of American, like, football show style. This would then mark the end of the first reel, and then essentially from this point on, it's as the film would have been in the US as well.
Yeah, basically they got Andy Chang in because he was sort of... The thing about Beck is he never uses guns, and Andy Cheng's sort of quite good at doing that.
Or he does until the last scene, which is a thing I'm a bit confused about.
It's a bit odd. But, like, because there's a lot of hand-to-hand stuff, Andy Cheng was good for that. Where he was sort of orientated. Yeah, still going for his notes. Mushrooms. So basically, director, I'll quickly throw this in while we're talking about it. Berg observes, and this is a quote from Peter Berg, Andy Cheng did a wonderful job of taking what was a Hong Kong-influenced style of fighting and reinventing it.
Yeah.
He took the acrobatics of the style and customized it to the Brazilian jungle setting. What comes across is a believable combat style for these guerrilla-style rebels, which we get later on, of course. So now, in some ways, it's like he invented a new style of fighting. And the Rock true though, because it's sort of like it's quite westernized, and it's sort of you get the feel of the old action movies,
yeah,
but you've got the sort of kung fu and the speed and the sort of character,
and it's action sequences that you haven't really seen, like there's a whole fight, like the whip fight and things like that, and then there's the whole human hacky sack is what it's called when he's being beaten up by the natives, and they're keeping him up in the air basically, like a hacky sack game is kind of that whole thing. you don't really see that any other film other than this.
It's got so much character.
The action sequences in this I do like, and it's not overladen with them either. No. It doesn't feel too much.
And they sort of do sort of feel they gel with the story as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're not too indulgent. You know, it's not like they drag them out. And if they do slightly lengthen them, it's because there's so much they can do with it.
Yeah.
And they can, you know, keep it going.
It's not just action for action's sake. It's sort of like, yeah, we can do this and it looks interesting and it's fun.
What do you reckon this guy's having for dinner?
Ooh.
Pasta?
I don't think he's a pasta guy. I reckon steak and chips. Yeah. Steak and fries.
But he's boiling water. You can hear the water boiling.
He's boiling water, so if he's boiling water, wouldn't necessarily be vegetables in the US because they don't really boil their food that much. What'd they boil over there?
Pasta. Dream.
Yeah, but pasta's so boring. He doesn't look like a pasta.
He looks like an Italian mafia-y kind of chappy, bit of a gangster thing. Except he's not really. He's sort of got the Italian American. I don't know
what he's eating. We'll go with pasta because he's boiling something.
Yeah. Right, that was a silly question.
Drag down to a stop.
Yeah, I'll talk a bit about Andy Chang later on, I guess. I'll come back to that because I've got some other quotes, which some stuff The Rock said about him and stuff. Right, better talk more about the numbers for this film. How much money it made. Yeah, so like I said, budget was 50. No, I didn't say that. I didn't say that at all.
No.
It was 85.
85.
Estimated at 85 million. Opening weekend in America. I like this use of Johnny Cash here.
Yeah, Johnny Cash, who died like just before the film came out.
Oh, really? Yeah, that makes sense. About that.
So that was when he passed away. So Don't Take Your Guns to Town by Johnny Cash.
Cracking soundtrack. This has some good stuff, and
there is, and this is the score by Harry Gregson-Williams that we're hearing. Yeah, here, which is a lot of guitar mixed with sort of Brazilian sounding. Like you have the lots of the whistle and things like that going.
Yeah.
On. So you and Bremner there as well.
Kind of an odd little sort of role. But
really strange character this, because, I mean, Ewan Bremner's Scottish.
Yeah.
And he's wearing all sorts of Scottish garb and he's playing bagpipes in the end, but he's doing the entire thing with... It's
sort of half Scottish, half Irish.
A bit of an Irish accent he's doing, which is really strange, because he could just do his normal accent and just make it slightly less... less to harder to understand. I don't know exactly what was going on with his accent in this, but I get the impression he just wanted to just do something completely ridiculous, and this is what he wound up doing.
Well, didn't you say that there was? It's a lot of cows. didn't you say there was like a sequence, a longer sequence here?
Yeah, when they were flying over, originally the plane was going to stall. It was just going to stop working, and then they were coming in for a crash landing, and then Ewan passes The Rock a screwdriver, says, let's put it in the hole and twist it, because he has to restart the car with the screwdriver while they're in the air. And they sort of just survive. And there's a random little joke in there where he says, you've got very big knees for a little fella. Towards The Rock, which is a strange line. But
well, he's got the four-leaf clover on the back of the plane, look.
Yeah, so he's an Irish Scotsman.
50-50. Cover both bases. I love his little Jeeps.
Yeah, sort of back to the Jurassic Park Jeeps thing. Which is what we did last week.
In all fairness, they filmed a lot of the stuff. This is all filmed in Hawaii.
Yeah.
But we can dip it.
Well, this was filmed on Honolulu. It's a different.
I think they did some film on Oahu, which is where they did the raptor. The chase sequence and what they called the. I've forgotten already. After re-listening to the commentary that these people did. And, but they did a lot of the stuff on... What was the main... I can't remember.
I don't know. I don't think you ever got to the bottom of the pronunciation of it.
So sorry. If anyone's listening in Hawaii, I'm sorry.
Eldorado is one of the original titles for the...
title. And the town that they arrived at is called El Dorado. Yeah.
Welcome to the Jungle was actually its first title, and then they changed it to The Rundown later on.
Yeah. After El Dorado. El Dorado's not a bad name.
The full three are perfectly good names. I just don't understand why The Rundown wasn't used for everyone, but whatever.
Unless there was maybe another film.
See, I'm not sure. I'm not aware of what it is because you search for the rundown. This is the only film that comes up.
Sean William Scott making his entrance.
Yep. Sort of in the time period where he was doing a few action films, sort of Bulletproof Monk and this, sort of around about the same time.
Yeah, he came off Bulletproof Month. Bulletproof Month?
Bulletproof Month.
For April, shoot me.
Which does feel like the running time of Bulletproof Monk, I have to say. It does feel like it's about a month long.
Yeah, I'll talk a bit about that later on. I'll talk about the stunts.
Film. Terrible.
The
trailer's quite funny, though.
Which is interesting. I posted that up on the... That's on the Facebook
couple of days ago,
opening weekend in the USA, it was 28th of September 2003, and it was released in 3,152 screens, grossing $18.5 million. In the UK, the next year, 28th of March 2004, we got it in 294 screens, which is quite a massive release for here, but it only grossed $635,000, so...
And I wasn't part of that figure. I didn't see this in the cinema. I didn't see this until it came out on DVD.
I don't imagine this had a huge run. I imagine.
Well, if it didn't earn that much money, it probably was in the cinema.
I imagine this was sort of like
dropped out
2 or 3 weeks, and then it was sort of and then it was sort of out. Italy, it made €113,000 on the 7th of March 2004, and it was only in 71 screens. €90,000 in Netherlands, 1st of February 2004, only in 45 screens. And in Spain, it was released in 300 screens on the 25th of January 2004, but it only grossed €683,000. So not massive. We got some admissions info, which always good to have. Germany, opening weekend. You're looking about 400. About 440,000 people went to see that in the first 2 weeks that it was open. And then Spain, roughly about 400,000 again. So, I don't know, not a huge amount of...
Yeah.
It just didn't...
I think it might have been a lack of advertising or just people's sort of assumption that it was just going to be a shit action movie with a wrestler in it.
Yeah.
Which is really a type of film. It's more now because I know John Cena's done a couple and Stone Cold did a few as well. Just generally terrible action movies. But
going back to the whole Guy Ritchie point you made earlier, that sort of the guns thing, the sort of then they do really slow motion shots of the guns and they sped them up, that sort of thing. Isn't that how they did that?
Definitely, they did it. They filmed everything in slow motion and then sped up transitions, did some 2D transitional effects and things like that, and sort of made it like a mind's eye sort of sequence.
Got the lava lamp, and here we have the man himself, Mr. Christopher Walken, who plays one just an absolute
always a fun person to watch performing anything, especially if he's in something that's not too serious. It's you can just have a whale of a time with Christopher Walken, and he's fun in this.
These one-liners in this film are they're just superb. They're just on a level of just pure excellence.
Yeah. I mean, have you got how he got cast in this in your notes anywhere? Or
no, I didn't do anything much about Christopher.
There isn't much about how he got cast. I don't really know how they came to him in this. Then,
well, I think they sort of just got him. I mean,
because I imagine it'd have been a short list of factors they wanted to do it.
What I've got about
a certain age group, and then they landed Christopher Walken.
What I've got was, it just says, and this is, if you search for the rundown, they've still got the website, it's still up.
Yeah.
And there's a lot, look at this massive bit of green screen there.
Green screen, yeah.
This is based on a real mine, isn't
some, it? Some of the special effects in this, obviously, wasn't the biggest budget they spent on special effects.
No, but it doesn't really, it's only a couple of shots, really.
In films, this isn't going to be a groundbreaking thing you're going to sit down and watch. It's a piece of fun. But... It's sort of like the Rush Hour sort of thing, where it's just, you sit down, you enjoy it, it's goofy, it's fun. You come away...
It has its own personality, it does its own thing,
You're not watching it for, it's cinematic, the way it advances cinema. You know, it's not a Citizen Kane or, big Oscar-grabby sort of film,
Got this bit about Hatcher, and he's sort of thinks that what he's sort of trying to sort of justify what he's doing is good. Basically, what I've got on, yeah, like I said, on the rundown website, if you go on it, there's some great bios. I think it's actually where a lot of the IMDb and wiki stuff's come from anyway, because it's all very similarly worded. And it's actually got a lot of info on there that I couldn't find anywhere else. So if you go on that, there's like a little behind-the-scenes thing. It gives you bios of most of the people. And they've also done a huge sort of... it's almost a press release of sort of, sort of the whole casting and stuff.
Yeah, it says, of info.
It didn't say how they got Christopher Walken. I assume they just... But
as I say, they probably just sent, offered the role to.
I think Chris Falken has always been one of those. He's sort of more of a jobbing actor.
Well, he's been in. I briefly looked at his bio in thinking I was going to go with his bio in this, but then decided I'd save that for later because there's so much information.
Just noticed the pig was outside again.
He's been in over 100 films, during the course of his career. He's been in. A lot. So yeah, he is really much like a working actor, basically. Yeah, he just takes a job,
and then just sort of
has fun with it and leaves, goes on to the next thing, sort of thing.
But anyway, it says here, the film, and this is sort of off the website, it says, the filmmakers hope Walken, an actor known for creating memorable characters, even with limited screen time, will inject his own trademark quirky malevolence to an atypical villain. Says Walken, on his portrayal of the despot, all villains have to have a rationale, and Hatcher thinks he's bringing civilization to the jungle. He tries to justify that by being a citizen of the world and helping the downtrodden. He's terrible.
Yeah, he's a deluded character, really. If you're looking at continuity goofs, watch the amount of juice she has in her glass. It goes up and down throughout the entire scene.
But, anyone really cares?
No.
Peter Berg notes it was he's saying it was a thrill watching Chris Walken. He's just truly a guy that could read the phone book and you would sit there and listen to him. Just one sentence with him is simultaneously terrifying, confusing, and hilarious. And endearing, probably. And all that at once. That's true. And I really need to sneeze. it's going to build.
It'll come back in later when you least expect it, most likely. Like one of those ones that's going to go away.
Yeah,
guy's meditating, sneeze meditating right now.
I'm gonna force it down.
It'll come back and haunt.
This is what happened. This is the sound of someone forcing a sneeze back into their body.
That'd be really awkward if you're trying not to sneeze, like in a cinema or anything. That's the noise you have to make to stop sneeze.
Yeah, or it's a. you'll follow. The pause. There's a shit got real moment in pretty much every scene.
But yeah, there is.
Yeah.
The shit gets real a lot, but then it sort of stops getting real and then comes back to being real again. I think the characters keep forgetting the shit got real and then it gets real for them every time they re-realize it.
No option C. Watching these two is just so entertaining.
They are very good. They are very, very good. And it's aided by the fact that nobody does... amusing, annoying character like Sean William Scott.
Yeah,
he can be so irritating but funny at the same time. Yeah. He pushes it right to that limit where he probably wouldn't be tolerable.
It's because he's so likable, and you kind of want to see what you kind of always on his side. That's why he can be so annoying and get away with it. Oh, shit! Just got real again. We'll do it. We should do it like a drinking game for this. Every time shit gets real, but another great shot there.
There is the way this is shot is...
just so much character.
So the thing you said about what you liked about it was how much depth there was to, a lot of the shots, there's some real depth in the camera work and stuff.
And a lot of movement as well.
Yeah.
I couldn't even begin to sort of figure out how people sort of this. If you watch Rosario Dawson in this, she's really good. She sort of plays it so subtly. She just sort of keeps just sort of watching.
This random moment. I mean, in the editing, they extended that. Clearly, they extended that by a good five seconds because it had made the door a lot quicker. But it's just this oddball, fun, amusing moment in the middle of the scene.
I mean, the whole El Dorado set was actually filmed up in California. And they sort of built the whole town. I've actually got a bit about that. Actually, I might as well talk about that now.
About the building of the town.
Yeah. Oh, Kahu was in the Hawaiian island, but we can talk about that when they get into the jungle. Yeah, so what they did was production designer Dewfield and his department designed, constructed and landscaped the whole village, which gave the filmmakers an inordinate amount of creative and technical options for filming. His team, working with Green's coordinator Danny Ondrejko, brought in hundreds of pounds of red dirt and thousands of tropical plants to lay the foundation for the enormous set. What followed were over 2 months of labor-intensive construction of 50 structures that make up El Dorado, including a church, markets, bars, restaurants, homes, and Hatch's two-story concrete observation deck, flanked by 500 feet molded hills of dirt fashioned from red-tinted wooden plaster that bordered...
they also lose ground brick is something they use a lot as well for that earthy red.
See, like that sort of stuff's great.
I like this.
Yeah.
Aww. That's ridiculous and fun at the same time, that.
I think it's the only time I've seen anyone sort of throw... I'm sure...
Disarm a weapon and trip someone up with the same maneuver here.
Oh, here it comes.
There's a great, great shot that both of us really like here where he throws a table and whips a table in half.
Yeah, it's just... It's wonderful. It just shows how...
Now that would really hurt, catching a whip.
Yeah. Christopher Walken's... Oh, look at that. How fucking awesome is that as a shot? You just don't know it yet. B.
Okay, so coming up on the tumble down the hill, where we're going to see some...
Well, I'll quickly finish up talking about this. Yeah, so that work. Basically, we literally created tropical rainforest in the desert points at Dewfield on the maintenance of the site. What they did was, set director, the guy called Gary Fettis, he, I'm sorry for this.
Keep going, because I've got stuff to say. About
So Gary Fettis, so what they did was they accented the town with every sort of embellishment, from markets overflowing with Brazilian candy, posters, magazine cigarettes and canned food, to several rusted out early model automobiles sitting on cinder blocks. And a Brazilian background artist filming on sets were amazed to recognize hometown brands placed throughout the sprawling set. I can come back to this in a minute if you want to talk about
this. Yeah, I mean, this is obviously the work of the body doubles rolling down the hill here.
I love this sequence.
You love that shot. There's no car in there. There should be a car somewhere in that shot, but it isn't. Essentially, Rocks, I think it might have been in like that shot there, for example. This, or there maybe, on a different... Some of these falls are brutal.
Yeah.
Dwayne The Rock Johnson's body double is actually his cousin, and on his way down the slope, sorry, he actually shattered his ankle. It's like one of the earlier stunts they did as well. He had to come through, work the entire film with basically having a broken ankle.
Pretty badass.
And also, if you look at Sean William Scott's character as he's falling down the hill, there the cuffs sort of reappear and disappear as it sort of goes on.
I like this shot.
And there you have it.
Yeah, apparently,
Time you have those jeeps in a film, they always get wrecked.
Yeah. Apparently, Sean William Scott wasn't a very good swimmer either.
Yeah, although was that a joke though?
I think it was
It's a joke. There's a joke made in the extras that implies that. It's just The Rock taking the piss. Yeah. There seems to have been an agreement made between Sean William Scott and The Rock that they're just going to take the piss out of each other in the interviews, I think. So every time they're sort of being interviewed by someone for the making of the film, they're just criticising each other the entire time. And one of the things The Rock says is that Sean William Scott can't swim forwards. He can swim sideways and backwards, but he can't swim forwards. What in the blue hell is that about?
The Rock is unstoppable. That's why it's called The Rock, Travis. You're not going to beat The Rock.
No.
He's a rock, man. You can't take down a rock.
He's the people's champion.
Is that what his nickname then?
Yeah, the people's champion, the great one. all sorts of nicknames The Rock has. Eyebrow raising, jabroni beating, pie eating.
Is this the Thunder and Lightning?
Thunder and Lightning, which was apparently sort of an ad lib.
And they liked it, didn't they?
That they liked and kept in. Probably just during the rehearsals or something, he sort of started doing that. It becomes a running gag in the film and is brought back at the end as well.
As does the car thing.
Yes, which I mentioned in the Evolution commentary, and I questioned, I think, at the time, did he actually create that ka-ka-ka thing? Is that something... And I think this is what I was thinking of, because I know he's done it more than once. But yeah, he does it here as well. So, this was, what, a couple of years after Evolution? When did Evolution come out? Can we remember that?
Don't throw shit like that my way.
Oh, no. It wasn't... either way, this was after Evolution. It was definitely after. I just can't remember exactly when it came out. I think it came out in 2001.
That's what I thought.
So, yeah, Ka-ka-ka-ka being a thing
I'm pretty sure
Sean William Scott's done a few
2001.
Times.
It is 2001. Yeah. Just covering ourselves in case we say, oh, it's 2002.
Yeah.
It can't really be any other year. So, yeah. You got to love Travis' character in this. He's just so relentless and he's sort of... so determined. He just never gives up and he just keeps going. But he's always so annoying. Very similar to sort of what he does in Cop Out.
Yeah, it's a similar sort of... It's usually the character he plays now.
Scott plays in.
I mean, after doing American Pie, he was sort of afraid of being typecast as an actor and sort of tried to do like slightly different things, sort of like this, because he did American Pie and then he did Road Trip and it's like, oh, they're kind of the same character really and things like that, so... He sort of made a move towards this, and I think this sort of thing is what he plays more often than not, actually.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about Sean William Scott?
I can bring up Sean William Scott. I've got a little bit about him. not much to say, really. He's the youngest of seven children, so big family.
Do you want to talk about the Tooth Fairy?
Fairy. I don't have anything to say about the Tooth
Fairy. Okay, well, this Tooth Fairy speech, which is possibly one of the best, greatest speeches ever made in a film ever.
Oh, right, yeah, no, it was
originally
going to
be a Winnie the Pooh thing. But Disney
a reference to Winnie the Pooh being stuck in the hole and he's trying to steal rabbit's honey. Yeah,
yeah. But Disney threatened to sue them, so they had to change it.
It is one of the greatest.
It's just
sequences in the film as well. This speech is just great. His delivery is amazing.
Gattle. It's brilliant.
It is a fun speech, and I'm going to talk all over it by talking about Sean William Scott.
Go on in.
Yeah, so youngest of seven children. Was born in Minnesota. His parents, no showbiz connections or anything like nothing like that in the family at all. He was inspired to become an actor when he was working at his local movie theater. He basically just got the job to watch films for free, which is pretty much the reason why anyone work in a cinema or theater, I think. And
it
liked
is so,
it so much that he
just
sort
films.
Of became infectious a bit and wound up wanting to become an actor after that. He moved to LA to try and pursue that, and then struggled on for a few years. He was in an Aerosmith video, Holding My Soul, in 1997.
Didn't know that.
It's one of his earlier things that he did. But obviously the first, like, his breakout role was as Stifler in American Pie in 1999, a role which apparently got paid $8,000 to do, which in terms of movie money is not very much, especially considering how big that character is in the film. But it made him $8,000 sort of well earned by him, because his salary would have gone up tremendously. In fact, by the time they did I think it was the third one, he basically got starring role credit, even though he's sort of still second billing. He basically got starring role salary for that, so he did him very well. But as I say, he sort of feared of typecasting for a little while, so that's why he started doing things like Final Destination, where he's like a nervous, nerdy type character, and Dude, Where's My Car?
Yeah, Final Destination, it's weird when you go from American Pie to that one, because he's sort of like the bumbling sort of quiet character.
Different character, and Dude, Where's My Car? He's just like a fun, lovable stoner type guy. He's appeared in... he was in Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. He played an animal rights activist in that, and then he was in this not long after with The Rock. He and Rock reunited in another film they did, Southland Tales.
Not
long after
that.
Have you not seen it? It's fucking terrible. It's boring.
Are they good in it? It's just bad script and bad.
I honestly can't remember how good people are in it, because I don't actually think I got through it.
Oh, really? That bad?
It's not a good film. It's boring as anything. Just a sort of a rundown of the other films he's been in. Evolution, as we said, in 2001. He's in all of the American Pie film, or the key American Pie films, 1, 2, American Wedding, and American Reunion. He's in Bulletproof Monk and Old School. Both came out the same year as this, as did American Wedding. God, he did a lot of films in 2003. He was in The Dukes of Hazzard as Beau Duke, which also didn't do very well. He sort of had a run of not so great films, actually. Southland Tales, Mr. Woodcock.
Don't really like that much.
Role Models in 2008, a film that we both liked quite a lot.
Very good film, though.
Very good in that.
Opposite Paul Rudd.
Yep. He's in Balls Out, which isn't a good film. He's in Cop Out, as we mentioned again, as Dave.
He's in that film.
The Turd Burglar.
Yeah. Gary the Tennis Coach, isn't he? That's a fucking bad film.
He was in Goon, which was a hockey movie. He was going to make Hit Somebody with Kevin Smith and then took The Goon instead. Another hockey movie, sort of.
After
agreeing to be in Hit Somebody, which I think sort of rubbed Kevin Smith up the wrong way a little bit. But hey ho. He wanted to make a cocky movie and he wound up going with Goon, which is all right. It's not brilliant, though. More recently, Movie 43, which was that movie that was absolutely terrible, that had a huge
amount of
cameos and stuff in it. It's a sketch film, but it's terrible, apparently. He's in the Happy Birthday segment in that.
Okay.
That's Sean William Scott.
But we love Sean William Scott because he's entertaining.
And he's good in this.
And he seems like such a lovely guy.
He does. He does. It's always entertaining to watch. It's
P. That'd be good for a t-shirt. Find a way. P. I love this thing.
it's the silences in this. Yeah. The reactions are what make this scene completely.
It's just... Gotta love it. Gotta love it.
Yeah. So awkward, but it's a funny awkward, this. It's
yeah, they did film cringy. A lot of this stuff on the same island that they filmed Jurassic Park. Kauai in Hawaii.
It looks more Lost World than Jurassic
Park.
It
does. But, I mean, I can't get it out. No. No.
And he never actually would have been able to whip it back in. So
I know,
like until he's unhandcuffed again, he's sort of just got his cock out essentially.
Yeah,
it's just never. It would be the way it would work. Obviously, they don't have that in the film. But
and he never zips it back up either.
Never zipping it up is one thing, but the fact that he can't flip it back in. I'm doing an awkward thrusting movement as I say that.
Very sexy, Neil.
It was lovely. For my lady fans.
What do you think, girls?
None of which are here. Anyway, were you...
I might as well talk about The Jungle. So they... Ooh, I love that shot. What is this?
My favourite bit in this is where he's sort of teasing him.
Yeah. It's just...
And he's like... Travis, he gets so annoyed.
Yeah. In the cuffs. Oh, and he starts making a fun. Well, problems. So yeah, basically they were going to, I mean, because this is set in Brazil, it's meant to be Brazil, South America, and they considered filming it there, but they had a scouting trip down there.
This is the bit I like with Rock. So he gets really grumpy.
Yeah. Oh, he's in the Kaka car. Yeah, there you go.
That's what you mean about the chemistry of the two of them.
But yeah, when they went down to do a sort of scouting trip in Brazil, they were there about 5 minutes and they all got held up and all their stuff got nicked.
Yeah.
And they were like, nope.
Not shooting here.
Bollocks to this.
We'll go to Hawaii where everyone's helpful and friendly.
Yeah. Yeah, there was quite a few, and there was sort of Berg, Misha Dufield, and the executive producer Rick Kidney, and their escorts. There's some armed bandits that came outside, attacked them outside the city of Manaus. They just basically used all their cash, all the camera equipment, but they were just like, "This is shit." But then they still utilized a few of the moments from it, infusing the film's dialogue as well as costume and production designs with the experience. So there was a few things they did take away from it. So, not an entirely unproductive experience.
No.
Good news for Hawaii.
Yep.
Yeah, so they basically, the film commenced on the Hawaiian island of Oahu, which is, oh no, Akehu is actually a Hawaiian priest. So I just read that, it's just the way it's worded. is Akehu, spelled K-A-H-U, Kahu, is a Hawaiian priest who presided over a traditional blessing, courtesy of
this
the rock.
Very alien.
Yeah.
Inspired, clearly. The way they did the monkeys in this, sometimes it's real monkeys, sometimes it's a hand puppet. So any time it's sort of an up close shot.
Looks good though.
It's a hand puppet, and then obviously there's a stuffed monkey that humps in. They actually had to shoot this twice when the monkey's humping his face.
Right.
Because originally the monkey was lower down and it sort of implied very nasty things. And to make it sort of a bit more friendly, they moved him slightly higher up.
Yeah.
So it didn't look like essentially he was fucking the rock in the mouth, I think is the is the problem.
Yeah, so they filmed it on Oahu, which is where they filmed the sort of outdoor sort of chase sequence. It's the Gallimimus herd, isn't it?
Yeah.
In Jurassic Park, it's that sequence. So that's on the same island. That's sort of, the rock was a former resident of the island as well. If that's any, if you wanted to know that. They presided over a traditional blessing, It's quite interesting. So they had 5 weeks of filming expansive jungle exterior scenes followed before the company returned to Los Angeles. Other locations used for filming included Hollywood, Hancock Park, the Tropical Garden of the Los Angeles Arboretum, which provided the backdrop for the Rebel campsite. And they had some sound stages in Van Nuys, which housed several sets, including the ingeniously designed underwater cavern and the tunnel which led to the entombed Gato Diablo.
Yeah.
And the Amazonas bar where Marina works. Or Mariana works, even. The El Dorado set was actually located 50 miles north of Los Angeles in the foothills of the San Gabriel Mountains. It was constructed within a 4-acre parcel of land. Which also included a work area for the crew and a holding pen for hundreds of animals. So there we go.
I think it's the same spot that they use. They use it in Arrested Development for Mexico.
Oh, that same
bit. Because there's the church that you see in it. That's what I sort of use as a church, I think, in
the same
Arrested Development. You can see it in this. I'm pretty sure you can essentially see the same building stood there. And it's popped up in a few things. I know they also used it in the season, I want to say it's the season 2 finale of Angel, when they go to, what's the name of the character's name? The demon who can listen to people sing.
Lorne.
When they go to Lorne's home dimension, his home world, and it's like that village set where they've got them tied to the post in the middle. They use it there as well. It seems to be a lot of LA productions seem to go there if they need to, a different,
I thought they,
thing
took down all the sets afterwards, but.
But it, I think what it might be that, is, because it's, I think you build your set inside this sort of area, and that church building is nearly always there. I think it's a permanent feature of it.
Okay.
But because it always looks slightly different, but it seems to have this.
Unless it's
building
the same.
Always in common, and it looks the same all
unless
the time
it's a it's like a little demountable building which they just sort of have in a backlot and they just wheel out when they need it.
Possibly. Although it just seems to be used all the... I don't know. I'll point it out when we get there later at the end of the film, but I think it's actually a location in LA that's used a lot, and then people just come in, build their own buildings within it to make it look different, and then move on.
That's true. There we go.
Hide out back like this is the human hacky sack sequence.
I might as well finish off talking about the stunts then, I guess. So The Rock explains Andy Chang has a modern approach to designing fights that incorporates everything, strength, speed, and agility that people can relate to. He always wants to make things different, which in turn makes Andy very unique. Chang also serves as a second unit director with additional second unit direction from EJ Forster. And they work closely with Peter Berg to inject creative and sometimes humorous elements into the picture's plentiful action. The transformations in both Sean and The Rock are evident in both of their leaner physiques, particularly for The Rock, who shed close to 40 pounds for the role.
Yeah.
And Scott, because
obviously, as a wrestler, you have to be a pretty fucking big guy because you're surrounded by other giants. So he would have actually lost weight to do this. Which
yeah,
is,
all this wire work is just brilliant. And like we say in the short, Sean and Scott just finished shooting Bulletproof Monk,
that's shot.
Which required 5 months of aerial wire work, training, and conditioning. So basically, he was sort of geared up. It was sort of a big bonus. Sort
like
of
that idea
him.
Completely breaks the laws of physics. Yeah, that, yeah. It's fun.
Yeah.
Nipping up is something that The Rock does in his wrestling thing as well. He can nip up. Where you sort of lean back and you flip yourself up to standing from lying down.
He's good at that.
Yeah, something he can do.
And here they come.
This was actually The Rock, which they don't really have a shot of his face when he does that stunt, but that's actually him, as is this. He did, I mean, in terms of the stunt work, it's... He did basically as much as was necessary. Basically, he's like, if it serves the story and the audience are going to clearly see it's me and it's going to be enjoyable, then I'll do the stunt, but... If there's, like, really no point in me doing it, then, you know, get my cousin to do it. He's a stuntman. He'll do it better than I can anyway. Sort of no point in me risking myself for that when, you know, it really wouldn't benefit the film. So he sort of had it. I think he had quite a good approach to the stunts in this.
Apparently he got held as a CGI shot there.
Yeah, it's three different shots. One starting off on Ernie Reyes Jr., then a transitioning shot of basically background people and then onto The Rock. Three separate shots transitioned into each other with a digital axe to link them all together.
But I quickly finish off talking about the thing. So basically,
love the stunt coming up.
This is sort of like a quote from that's cool.
It's a mean looking shot. It's clearly a rubber sticking out of this shot as well. I just like the illusion of someone being whacked around the head by something.
Yeah. Basically, Sean William Scott says he loved being physical. I like the action that I get to do. It's not like I'm the Terminator or Rambo. Travis is the guy who's not going to give up. He's not a great fighter, but he's always bouncing back. Works really well with what The Rock is doing. Basically, extensive stunt rehearsals, beginning pre-production, prepared The Rock and Scott for what the filmmakers had in store for them. Over the course of filming, they were both strung upside down from a 50-foot tree. And that scene they filmed for several days with that one. And then Scott dove from an exploding bus, and The Rock, strapped into aerial wires, was hurled more than 30 feet through the air, which is what we just saw.
Yeah.
So pretty demanding, really. So there we go.
So we are. I'm going to talk about Ernie Reyes Jr. for a bit.
Yeah, might as well,
because he's going to pass away soon. So Ernie Reyes Jr., He's sort of playing this guy here, the sort of leader of the rebels. He's actually an American. He was born in San Jose, California. Essentially, he's a professional actor / stuntman. He's one of these sort of
rounders,
rare breeds where he does acting as a main thing. He's able to carry his own films and TV shows and stuff like that. But he's also a stuntman in his own right. And in this, he did like obviously his own stunts and he has his own character as well. He's first generation American. Oh no, second generation American, I think. His grandparents were Filipino immigrants. He was born into a family. His dad was a stuntman, so, and he started doing stunts at the age of six. Sort of became his dad's sort of stunt team and things like that. Which is the West Coast Demo Team, they're known as. His feature film debut came in 1985. He was in Berry Gordy's The Last Dragon. And the same year, he was in Red Sonja, the Arnold Schwarzenegger film. In the 80s, I think it was around 88, he had his own television series called Sidekicks, which was a Disney TV show about a kid who was played by Ernie, who he's the last electric knight. He had special powers, and he was a karate expert and basically used his powers to beat up bad guys and bullies in his school and sort of out on the streets and stuff like that. And was able to overcome his villains with the advice of his dead father. So, I don't know, strange sounding show, but he was the lead in it, and it ran for like one season of 20 odd episodes or so. He was the stunt double for Donatello in the Ninja Turtles film in 1990. Which then led him to obtaining his own role in the sequel to Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and the Secret of the Ooze. He played Kino, who is like a pizza delivery boy in that. He's pretty a key character in that film. From then on, he's sort of just stunt work on and off, really. He's in Rush Hour 2, plays Zing, and he's in this as well. He hosted his own MTV martial arts reality show called Final Foo.
Cool.
Where contestants would come together and they would spar with each other on like a point scoring system and things like that. I think that ran for like one or two seasons. Didn't do hugely well, but it happened. He's fought professionally as well. He has a 3-0 record. He's never been beaten or wasn't beaten in Strikeforce, which was a martial arts fighting organization. Which ran for quite a while. It went defunct in 2013, though.
Shit just got real.
Again. He did motion capture stunts in Avatar and in Alice in Wonderland as well.
Okay.
He doubled, I think it's like, oh, I can't remember what character. It was like Tweedledum, I think, or something like that. He doubled. Most recent thing he's done is he was in an episode of NCIS Los Angeles. The episode called The Frozen Lake, where he played a Nepalese soldier who is an expert in knife fighting. So yeah, that's Ernie Reyes Jr.
Cool. So getting back to the film. Shit's going down in the jungle.
Yep. Christopher Walken's coming in and he's just killing, murderizing these people.
Really well lit sequence. Really good little
well
thing.
Cut together as well.
Yeah. All right. Stop hitting me. Yeah, cool. What can we talk about? Lots of stuff.
So I've got more cast, but I think I'll lay off on the cast.
I've got most of the crew to do, but for the time being. So we can do that, maybe do that later on if you need to. I'll talk about how this sort of came about, this whole film. Basically, while they were in the production on The Scorpion King, producer Kevin Misher, who's a former president of production at Universal Pictures, and The Rock had discussed collaborating on another project. Producer Karen Glasser had recalled a compelling...
Shit just got real again.
Again.
Twice in one scene.
Karen Glasser had recalled a compelling two-fisted adventure story she had read and brought it to The Rock and Misha's attention. Once he basically set... You know, his eyes on it. He's like, yeah, this is great. I'm up for this. They fast tracked it, and then it was quite an innovative sort of thing. And then they sort of had the action as well. So it was sort of, and it was sort of they sort of knew Rock was about to sort of become big. So I think they were sort of hoping that this would sort of make that bridge.
It's pretty obvious.
Had the Scorpion King come out, and then he guest hosted Saturday Night Live as well, which went down really well.
I'll talk about The Rock's bio probably towards the end of the film, because that'll take me a while. Well,
this is what he says about it. He says after his big screen debut in The Mummy and then Scorpion King, he said the last two movies I've done, well, the only two movies I've done were period movies, so I was looking forward to doing something contemporary, playing a character with some mystique while injecting a little humour without losing the spirit of the character. Beck is the quintessential reluctant hero, one of those classic characters who can handle any situation but whose problems just keep piling up. So yeah, and I've got some cool quotes like sort of from the sort of filmmakers and the sort of cast about each other, which are quite interesting. I mean, oh, shit's got... Nah, that didn't get real.
Yeah, shit's going to get real again in a moment, because she's going to try and kill him.
That's when shit's going to get real. Yeah, anyway, they were saying... Mitchell was saying the remarkable thing about The Rock is he's very capable of performing the stunt, often better than most stunt doubles. The great fun in all of this is that you keep the camera rolling and the audience knows it's him pulling off these incredible stunts. And on top of all that, it's his style and his on-screen presence. Of course, as a producer, you're thinking, what are we doing? That's our star out there. But, you know, if they knew he could handle himself...
It's a good shut up here.
Yeah.
Can you shut up?
I like the fact, like, no matter... It's sort of one of those sort of buddy sort of things. It's not really a buddy thing, but, like, you expect on most of these films, by the end of it, they sort of quite like each other.
Yeah, these
but
two
even
don't.
At the end, they just sort of... they still get on each other's tits. Like, and you know that if they didn't see each other again, they'd be happy with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I mean, it's worth noting that this would have been, there was plans to make this like a sequel, like a trilogy of films.
That would have been so good.
So they might have sort of gotten to like each other maybe towards the end of the third one, maybe. But yeah. in this film on its own, no, they don't really warm to each other at all. Beck sympathises with the character, but he doesn't like him by the end there.
I quite like these wide sort of locations. Sort of thing.
Again, special effects are a little bit dodgy in this, but it gives a good example of geography, how far away the team are and everything.
It's really mad. Too much. It only sort of looks bad when it transitions between the live action and the CGI, really.
The zoom out from the boat and things like that.
Like amazing sets there.
Yeah, using the
amazing
scenery.
Sets, we're talking about scenery. Yeah. Might as well dip. While I'm talking about Misha, I might as well talk about some of the flipping crew, or otherwise I'm never going to fucking do it. Or I could just... we'll just save the crew, maybe do a quick expert on it in a minute.
Alright, I mean, we've actually only got 35 minutes left.
So. Oh, fuck, I'm not going to get through them all. Never mind, we'll do that. We'll do a little expo afterwards.
Yeah.
So do you want to talk about Rosario Dawson?
Rosario Dawson. Okay, yes, let's bring up her bio then.
Rosario Dawson.
She was born in New York City. Her mother was a writer and singer who is of Puerto Rican.
It's early. We've only just had breakfast. Leave us alone.
Her mother was only 16 years old when Rosario was born, and she never married Rosario's biological father, who is Patrick C. Harris. Rosario never took his name either. When Rosario was 1 year old, her mother married Greg Dawson, who was a construction worker, who essentially just loved and raised Rosario as if it was his own daughter. Essentially, she's always considered him her father rather than her biological dad.
It's a rather touching story, Neil.
At the age of 21, the family moved into an abandoned building squat on Lower East Side of Manhattan, where her parents basically installed the plumbing, they wired all the electrics for the building, and created basically their own affordable accommodation where Rosario and Clay, her half-brother, could grow up. Dawson cited this part of her life as teaching her sort of valuable lessons in regards to if you want something better, you have to basically do it yourself. Mm. So she's got quite a can-do sort of attitude about her, I think. As a child, she made a brief appearance on Sesame Street. And at the age of 15, she was discovered. She was sat on a front porch, and then Larry Clark spotted her, sort of sat there, and sort of liked her and stuff like that. I wound up casting her in 1995's The Kids. Have you seen Kids?
Nope.
It's a film about kids fucking, basically. Right, okay. And how, you know, getting drunk, getting high, being irresponsible. It's a pretty dark film. It was quite controversial at the time as well, because the kids in it were actually sort of appropriately aged for their characters, and they were all underage and performing these sort of...
Right.
Doing these sort of scenes and things like that. Quite controversial, but she was in it, and she's quite good in it as well. 1999, she sort of had a bit of a turn. She was doing music for a while. In 1999, she teamed up with Prince for the re-release of 1999. The new mixed version of that, she recorded an introductory voiceover, which supplied sort of commentary on the world before the new millennium and things like that. She's in a Chemical Brothers music video for Out of Control. And she's also... does the intro and outro for the Outkast album Speakerbox and The Love Below.
Okay. Didn't know that.
Yeah, she does the intro and outro for that. She played Edward Norton's love interest in the 2002 Spike Lee film 25th Hour. And in 2004, she was in Alexander... which is an Oliver Stone flick. She then appeared on stage. She did Two Gentlemen of Verona, which came up in another commentary we did recently. I think it might have been the Jurassic Park one again. where she did Shakespeare. It's the first time she's actually done stage work and things like that. After that, her sort of career took off properly then. Rent in 2005, Sin City in 2005. She was in Clerks 2 in 2006. And then that same year, she actually co-created a comic book miniseries called Occult Crimes Task Force. Yeah. And she was at the 2007 Comic-Con to promote that as well. Also in 2007, she was in Death Proof, Quentin Tarantino flick. Yeah. And she teamed up with a friend, Talia Lugosi, who she met at the Lee Strasberg Academy, and she produced a film and starred in the film called The Descent in 2007. Not The Descent as in the horror movie, a different film entirely. She was in 7 Pounds with Will Smith, 2008, and in Eagle Eye, same year. She sort of returned back to music briefly. She's on the Kasabian album, West Rider Pauper Lunatic Asylum.
She's a singer then, or...?
Yeah, she's sung. Yeah. She's featured singing on West Rider Silver Bullet track on that album. More recently, 2010, Percy Jackson and The Lightning Thief, or Percy Jackson and the Olympians, The Lightning Thief. Long-ass title, very jerky. As Persephone, and she was in Unstoppable as well, the Unstoppable train movie. 2003, she was in a film called Gimme Shelter, a little independent movie, and she's been announced as having a role on the upcoming Daredevil TV show. She's got a guest starring role in that, so
cool.
Still going strong. Rosario Dawson.
This is...
What did I miss?
Well, they missed this bizarre... like. It's always these things, like, if you've got, like, a treasure possession, and you're, like, in the heart of South America, like, some old Inca gold or something, let's put it in the most inaccessible place that we will never even ever get back to it ourselves.
Yeah.
Let alone...
I like the idea of an ancient safe where there's one route through it to get to the gold. It is... I like the idea. I mean... It's very Indiana Jones, but...
I mean, you can't really do any sort of action adventure sort of things like this without sort of...
With relics.
Without reminiscing, you know, it's like the Matthew McConaughey stuff, the Sahara and what's the other one, the Fool's Gold, you know, they've all got that element of, you know... The guy
but, this is really the weakest part of the entire film is the whole Gato story. It's if you're thinking back to the film, it's the stuff you forget.
Yeah.
First thing you'll forget is the Gato stuff in it. The fun stuff is the character stuff,
and stuff with
the actual rundown element to it, and this sort of stuff you forget about immediately. But it advances the plot just enough, and they don't dwell on this too much to slow the plot down completely. It slows down a little bit at this stage, but it's nowhere near as bad as the plot to Adam's Family, where it really just brings everything to an absolute halt.
Yeah.
A commentary, incidentally, you will be hearing next week.
Oh my god, it's all gonna cave in.
It's coming up as probably the worst, especially this shot. Oh, it's horrible. It's horrible. It's horrible.
Yeah, it's... it's not nice.
Not a good shot. Not a good shot.
But it's only...
Well, it's a good shot. It's just...
Not right.
Needed more money on the special effects to pull that off properly, I think.
That's why it's a very short shot, so it doesn't really matter too much.
Yeah, that's all right. Again, not watching this for its... expecting it to be breaking ground or anything.
Oh, aren't they? What's the deal with these fruit things?
The Conolobos. Conolabos. Let me bring up the correct bit of trivia for that.
Did you mention the Arnold Schwarzenegger cameo at the beginning?
I mentioned that it was Arnold Schwarzenegger, but you were talking about numbers and stuff at the time, so I couldn't really go
through. Do you want to quickly do that? Because
Very, very briefly then, his cameo was filmed on the same day that he did an appearance as the Terminator at the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
They were filming that. It was completely unprepared for him being in this. Him and Rock and the filmmakers basically just sat down chit-chatting, because Rock and Schwarzenegger are quite good friends.
Yeah.
And he was like, you should do a cameo, you should do a little cameo. And he was like, oh, okay, I'll do one, I'll do one, it'll be fun. They talked him around to doing it, and you just have that one shot where they're just passing each other, and he's like, you know, have fun, which is seen by a lot of enthusiasts and like action movie enthusiasts as sort of as Schwarzenegger passing the torch on to sort of the next generation of action hero.
But I think that's kind of a bit... It's
reading too much into just a silly little scene, really, to be honest.
Although
it is kind of... It does fit... It rest, sort of looking back on it, it works in that regard, but that wasn't the intention, obviously.
But like, the thing is, though, like, I think it's Peter Berg. I think in one of the interviews he was saying it doesn't really work like that because The Rock is so different from, like, the Schwarzenegger and stuff.
Yeah, people were sort of saying, oh, he's going to be the next Schwarzenegger, Stallone, sort of the next big action star, where what he does is the action movie. You look forward to his action movie every year sort of thing. But he's got more charisma than both of those actors.
Yeah.
It's not... He works as a character. I mean, if you look at the other films he's been in, like, if you look at him in Too Cool, for example, he's essentially just this... What is he in that? Is he a gay... cowboy country loving wannabe singer star,
something like
in that bizarre character, not an action star role at all, but but he's able to pull that sort of thing off because of the level of, he's somewhere between like a Schwarzenegger and a Will Smith. He's probably closer to a Will Smith sort of in terms of what he does as an actor. I think he's closer to that. Pure charisma, entertaining to watch, fun guy who is also good at action sequences and stuff like that as well. So,
yeah,
different breed.
Yeah, I mean, Mark Abraham, the producer, he says anyone who knows The Rock knows that he is very witty and charming. The rundown is going to gives him a chance to showcase those qualities on screen. He has great instincts as a performer, and his career as an athlete gave him an incredible drive and discipline. But the truth is, he was just born with natural star power, which I think is a good way to
And the other thing about wrestling in particular is it's a big over the top performance. The entire it's stage acting is basically what wrestling is.
Well,
so he'd have learned a lot about sort of projecting himself as a character, playing a character for like years, basically when he was wrestling for like 8 years. Before this, he was wrestling since 1996. He had a good 9 years of experience under his belt of just acting as a character. So talking a lot about acting and performance as well.
Well, it's funny you say, because Peter Berg also says stuff about that. It's quite interesting what he says. He says, because he was sort of really struck by the sort of WWE performances. He says, when The Rock appeared in these giant stadiums, he would deliver these long monologues where he would go off taunting members of the audience or taunting other wrestlers. And it was real theatre. And his audience was galvanized, 35,000 people, and he had them right in the palm of his hand.
Yeah.
And I realized that the guy was has tremendous acting chops and a commanding presence, and he had been honing them every day, learning how to control an audience. So I was confident in his ability to hold his own in any situation, even with a veteran like Christopher Walken.
Yeah, and he does. He does stand his ground. But it is true. I was into wrestling when I was in my teenage years and stuff like that, and it was mainly for The Rock was the reason I watched it, because it is just the best bits on it weren't. It's not the fights or anything like that. It's the going out on stage when he's talking to the audience or he's trash talking his opponents and things like that. And it's just the wit and charisma and the character was just entertaining to watch. It's like stand-up theatre, sort of weird, in a weird way. It's I like that shot. I completely agree with that, definitely. It's such an easy transition for him to make over to being a full-time actor.
Yeah. Back in El Dorado. got a couple of quotes.
I had your sneeze.
Yeah. See, that's what happens. I use the magic right.
That's why you did your meditation sound.
And I throw it across to you, and then you sneeze. See? So what I was saying is, I quickly finished up talking about this village because I sort of...
It's about to get wrecked.
It's about to get completely destroyed. So The Rock, commenting on the detail, went into the construction of the village. He says, what's amazing is that you can literally be dropped right into the middle of this set with your eyes closed, only to open them and think you're in a small South American town. The art department did an incredible job, and I think they did. I think this the set design on this, the art direction, cinematography, it's just great. Like,
it is, yeah.
You get a sense of like the place, you know. It's sort of, you get sort of immersed in it. It sort of becomes so background. It gets to a point where you don't.
Fornication. I love this delivery. Flying fornication.
Yeah. Yeah, because this is interesting. Like, in addition to looking authentic, it had to sort of withstand the rigors of, you know, the large scale, you know, action sequences and all that sort of thing. And at times, a visit to the set found horses, cattle, pigs, chickens, hundreds of background players, explosions, buildings shredded by gunfire, and dozens of fires burning all simultaneously. While all the cast and crew were doing their stuff. What, the fact or the sneeze?
It's the sneeze. And the fact, I was allergic to the fact it was so good.
Like, when you look at all the background shots, there's just animals all over the fucking place.
Yeah.
Like, and they just sort of, yeah. So they sort of went all out with it. You know, it's great. And like all those things in the background, all those little bits of branding and stuff, you know, they sort of done the research on it. And
I mentioned this in the Jurassic Park. I love the way the clouds hang low.
Yeah.
It's like that. When you capture that on film, it's fucking stunning. Stunning thing to look at.
Yeah, that sort of tropical.
So I'm going to briefly talk about Ewan Bremner.
Because we're going to need to get
him in. We'll move on from him very quickly, and he hasn't got much to talk about, to be honest. Born in Edinburgh, Scotland. He attended Davidson's Mains Primary School and the Portobello High School.
Yes.
He originally wanted to be a circus clown.
Right. Fair enough.
He was offered a chance in show business by television director Richard D. Brooks. Basically just started acting, just lucked into it, really. But yeah, wanted to be a clown originally, which I thought was interesting. His first notable role was as a schoolboy in Charles Gormley's Heavenly Pursuits in 1985. But the first thing that I think everyone, not really the first thing everyone, he was actually in the stage version of Trainspotting, completely screwing up the delivery on that. he played, the same role that Ewan McGregor has in the film version,
right,
on the stage version. And then they brought him on to, into the film as well. Where he played Spud.
Yeah.
Mark Renton, lead character in Trainspotting. Sorry, that's what I wasn't seeing in my... Yeah, he played Mark Renton on stage, Spud in the film version.
So I didn't realise, when was the stage version then?
Stage version was, I think it was the previous year,
1994.
I'm trying to find... Yeah, because Trainspotting came out in 95, was it?
I think so.
I didn't write it down. So it's in the 1995 stage version of Trainspotting, so...
Okay.
Trainspotting must have come out in 96 then.
Oh, okay.
I think they were a year apart.
Or are we like completely off and it's like 1998?
Something like that. It was in the notes. I shortened my notes down and then it stopped making sense. It was my screw up that. Other than that, he had a brief role in Snatch as well. He plays Mullet.
Oh, it is 96.
In Snatch, gets his head caught in the window of Vinnie Jones.
I built you a town. What?
That aside, he's been in quite a few Ewan McGregor films, actually. Black Hawk Down. He had a little role in Pearl Harbor as well. This, obviously, he was in The Reckoning. He was in Around the World in 80 Days as Inspector Fix.
Death at a Funeral he's in as well.
Death at a Funeral he's in a little bit later, in 2007. He was in Fool's Gold, which you mentioned just out of happenstance earlier.
Very similar sort of
thing. He was in an episode of My Name is Earl the same year, 2008.
Yeah.
He was in an episode of Spooks, which is a British spy TV show, which is rubbish, but I've mentioned it before, I think. and he was in Jack and the Giant Slayer, which is another film that's got Ewan McGregor in it as well.
Okay.
So, yeah, that's Ewan Bremner.
Shit just got real.
Again.
Down the town.
That's a shit got real moment, for sure.
Yeah.
Lock down the town.
This is cool. Oh, the amount of one-liners Christopher Walken has in this film is just...
It is. We keep seeing this pig running around now, which we happened across...
On a deleted scene.
On a deleted scene where he originally had a different death scene. We'll talk about it at the time, but... this pig is somewhat relevant. That's why he keeps getting a mention.
And it's arming up the town. Because it's about to get blown up.
After having had this DVD on for almost an entire day yesterday, the music that's being used in this tooling up sequence is It's annoying because it plays on loop on the opening on the main menu. DVD menu, and the DVD menu only runs for about 10 seconds. It's a really brief menu, so
I do like the score for this, I gotta admit.
Yeah, Harry Gregson-Williams.
Yeah. Talk about him. We'll cover him in the X-Pod.
Who pops up a lot, but doesn't really have much of a bio, apparently.
I've managed to find some good stuff about him, mainly off the rundowns, on the rundown website. There's a little bit about him. It's mainly, he's one of those people that sort of, you know, through his biography, filmography even, you know. Here we have the bagpipes. What the fuck is this? Can you do a good Christopher Walken?
Not really.
Give me the two.
There's so many people out there that can do much better Christopher Walken impressions. I sort of begrudge trying to do it.
Yeah,
but
mine's crap, but it's just fun.
The thing about the Tooth Fairy, I can do the pacing of it. I just can't do the voice.
Okay. About Tooth Fairy.
Tooth Fairy. It's the pacing of it.
Yeah.
I can't do his voice for the life of me. I can't do it. It's just not in me. But yeah, it's the delivery. If you want a good Christopher Walken impression, check out fucking actor escaping me. Kevin Pollock. Get out. Check out Kevin Pollock. He does an amazing Christopher Walken impression. Yeah.
This is just, this sort of humour is just sort of just full on, gives this film this sort of unique tone. It's just brilliant.
Considering he probably can't play the bagpipes, he doesn't do a bad job of pretending he can.
Well, I don't know, I was going to ask you that when you, I meant to ask you that, like, Ken
doesn't say anything about him, as far as I can tell. I don't think he can.
I'll Google it and see what comes up. Can Ewan Bremmer play the bagpipes?
I'll be surprised. It looks convincing enough, but I don't think he's actually playing it.
I don't think so either.
No.
But you never know. Is it really racist to assume everyone in Scotland plays bagpipes?
Probably is, yes. But that's a Hollywood trope that, you know, it's Hollywood racism that's been well established and continues to live on to, even to now.
Well, apparently
in Scotland wears a kilt, and that's a lot of cows. Everyone in Scotland wears kilts and can play the bagpipes is a thing.
Okay, I've just found a little Yahoo thing. Apparently, apparently the song is called Highland Laddie, if anyone's interested. Apparently, someone on Yahoo
Looked that up.
Yeah, that answer comes from someone called Miss Chief.
Thank you, Miss Chief.
That's
a good name you got there.
I don't know. I couldn't find it. I can't find an answer for that. But there you go, it's more trivia for you. Right, now this is where shit is just getting
Shit's just real from now on. Yeah.
Right, I'm going to talk a bit about sort of... I'll talk some more time. Yeah, his accent's just odd.
It is pretty strange, his accent.
Yeah, I mean, let's talk a bit about sort of bits and pieces, really. So, producer Abraham was saying that whenever we were working on an action set piece that involved The Rock, we made every attempt to shoot it without trickery. So it's The Rock's face on his body in those sequences. This is a star who really can do his own stunts. And then Peter Berg says, you know, I think he's a new type of action actor. He really is. He's not anything that I've been able to easily define. And his ability to take risks and try new things. Oh, Thunder and Lightning's coming back.
Yeah.
And to want to learn always surprised me. And made me just want to pull for him that much more. So, like, I think, you know, it's just sort of the mix you get for this film. It just seems like everything was sort of just in place to, you know, they got the right cast, the right crew. They just, everything sort of just seemed to just work itself out, and they got everything they wanted.
Yeah.
And that's why it's sort of, everything gels. That's why it's got so much personality, so much character. That's why this film's so good. It's the characters, it's the story, well, not so much the story, but like that, the humour, the action, it's just,
yeah,
it's just a cracking film, this. It's just so good.
I mean, in terms of films that are sort of tailor-made for Guy, it's what Guy's after more than anything else is escapism and just fun.
Yeah.
Is what you're after in a film.
I do
and
like
this,
that.
basically this is what this is. It's just a big escapism goofball movie.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it works well, and it's also well done. It's been
well crafted. It's so well crafted. I mean, look at the way this is, you know, like this.
Back to the Guy Ritchie sort
of thing. Yeah, I mean, you've got to, you can never underestimate how influential Guy Ritchie, like Snatch and Lockstock, I mean, gee whiz. How influential
people
those
slate them
really
a fair bit, but I'll slate Guy Ritchie off quite a lot, actually. There's a lot of Guy Ritchie haters out there, but
what a phenomenal director. I mean, in terms of visuals, the thing that what he's brought to cinema is insane. Same with people like Edgar Wright, and you know, and at this around this time, like you say in The Matrix, you know, the you know, revolutionary bits of cinema. It's just bizarre. This bit is this
it's
one,
very
okay, so
bizarre.
What,
sort of the
so this whole thing about the guns, I mean.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
Has he picked up a gun yet?
No. Every single gun he's picked up so far, he's disarmed in the same maneuver.
But now
he's
decides to sort of.
But now
change.
It's been used like, you know, bad things happen when I use guns, you know, and it's like he's got a mantra of not using gun, like a Batman thing, like he's not going to use a gun. But it's not that he won't use a gun. It's just that he will in order to save. I don't know. I don't get exactly.
I think he just doesn't want to have
it's
to
like
kill
been,
everyone in this
yeah,
town.
But he's now been forced to kill everyone in the town. It seems like a mixed message to me somehow. Like the film had a moral about not using guns, but it decided to throw that all out the window and just blow everyone up. I don't know. Because now he just does start murderizing people. Just
do we know what this music track is, or is this part of the score?
This is part of the score, I think.
I love it. It's just the way this is sort of.
Yeah, this is definitely score, you can tell.
Mm.
Which may mean that's that track that played in the club earlier was also score. It just doesn't sound like score.
No.
Yeah, but this is score.
This
but,
is just sort of... Like, well, this is a bad thing that is happening from him using a gun. He's killing a lot of people. People
he's
are
killing
dying.
Lots of bad people, though. But
I suppose they're pretty nasty, but they're only sort of doing their job, I guess.
He's doing it to... It just feels like he could have used the guns in an imaginative way to...
That's the money shot.
Sort of like, yeah.
And that's the other one. I love that. It just sums up the
that's
characters.
That's such a cheesy shot. That fucking,
it's so good, though.
The rock there. It just feels like they could have gone a little bit more like... Sort of like, think Hot Fuzz. The way they use the guns in the end of that and they don't actually kill anyone. But
oh,
it's,
what?
In
yeah,
order
yeah.
to take
okay,
everyone
what,
down.
Like he shoots like, an awning and that falls down on them and like knocks them out and something.
So, yeah, they could have done it like that where he's using the guns in a non-lethal way. But
yeah, okay.
Instead it just goes all out. Now I'm just going to kill everyone with guns.
Yeah.
It's very American, I guess. But I don't know. I don't quite understand the...
I'll be honest with you. It's one of the minor points in this film.
Cracking shot coming up with this where the top of the water tower flies straight into the camera. This shot here. Boof.
Yeah,
that's a practical shot. It's not special effects either.
Right.
Just lucked out with the way it fell. Fantastic stuff.
This
is where
he
the rock takes
down the building.
Out.
It is. Yeah. I love the shot. It's so fucking excellent. I'm going to knock down a building because I'm the rock.
Like, you're just going to clothesline a building. It's probably the most... It's probably the most immediate reference to him being a wrestler there is because clotheslines are a pretty standard maneuver in wrestling.
The other thing we haven't mentioned is the fact that a lot of the close-ups of his hands throughout the entire film aren't his hands.
Yeah, because wrestling... people, it's a bit of a bugbear where people, oh, wrestling's fake, blah, blah, blah. It's scripted, and there's a lot of the maneuvers are... implied to be one thing when they're not actually not quite that the one thing, but there is actually they do actually have to hit each other quite a lot.
I mean, it's still stunt work.
Yeah.
It's still heavy physical, you know, action, you know.
And,
activity.
You know, you punch people enough times, you're going to break your hands a lot. As a result of wrestling for so many years, he's broken pretty much every bone in his hand multiple times. So, like, in terms of... like close-ups of his hands and things like that. Like it's at the beginning where he's writing in the notebook and things like that. They tried to shy away from that a bit too much because you would just pay more attention to how mangled his hands are than you would the actual.
I'm like, thinking one of the I read somewhere in one of the trivia shots it was like, oh, his tattoo disappears off his wrist in one shot. I was like, well, it's probably because it wasn't his.
Yeah, I mean, he has got quite a lot of tattoos. His tattoos are on his arm. He's got a lot of Samoan tattoos on his upper arm.
Yeah.
Which I'll talk about in a bit. And he's got a Brahma bull tattoo in reference to his rock persona as well.
Yeah.
They usually cover them up in films. usually, not all the time, in the Fast Five, in Fast Five and Fast Six, they've got his actual tattoos, I think. But in this, they've added tattoos to him that aren't his, to suit the character, I guess.
Hmm.
I love that he catches the gun, though. That's neat.
Wow!
See, there, he disarmed him. Like, he's good enough shot with a gun to disarm a man.
Yeah.
With a sniper rifle held at an arm's length, which is an impossible thing to do.
There's a really good delete bit there when he hits him and he drops it. He's like, ow!
He said that there. They just used a different take, I think.
Oh, wow!
He says, whoa, oh, ow! Yeah,
he
does.
Funny, and he drops, he's like, ow!
Yeah, it's a different take.
I thought the ow bit was funnier. Oh, maybe this is it.
No, it's not.
Oh, no, that's when he gets shot. Apparently his bullet wound on him changes a lot of time as well, but... who cares?
Yeah, so this is, I think you can see it in this sequence. I'll point it out. The sort of church building, which looks...
Yeah, I've been looking.
Identical to me in a minute. It's... so you can look at it, you can see, like, they've obviously put the bamboo and shit behind him, but I think the building behind that is a real one. That's obviously been constructed there, behind them.
Mm.
But it's this sort of, like, white stone buildings that are there that I don't think are actually built. I think they're part of the main location. They've built all of these shacks around it to give it this sort of shantytown look to it. But
like in the back, like I was saying, you've got all the fires going, you've got all the extras. I mean, like all the costumes.
All the dirt and the mud, which they've added as well.
They've just gone full on with it. You know, it's brilliant. And this is sort of Hatch's.
Oh, yeah, apparently he's going to make a reference to Oompa Loompas in a moment.
Oh, yeah.
He wasn't He wasn't prepared to say Oompa Loompa because he'd never seen Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory or anything like that. He didn't know what an Oompa Loompa was. I think maybe he thought he was being racist.
Yeah, I think then Peter Pooh gave him a copy of it, didn't he?
He gave him a copy of the DVD to watch and he watched it and he was like, yeah, okay, I'll call him.
Which is quite funny.
I'll take option A.
Option A.
He knows he's fucked, though.
Yeah.
It's a good exit for the character, this. But yeah, this is where the original cut of this, I don't know why they changed it. You can see that pig there.
Yeah, on the, just underneath it.
Up on the shot there, just towards the left. When he stops here, he's stopping right next to that pig, and he drops to his knees, and he looks right at the pig, and his last words are, pig? And then he dies, which I think is a funny last line. I guess they wanted it to be more...
oh, shit's not bad.
Yeah, it's just pig? It's not as good as pig, which pig? Is so random. That shot, that building behind them, the church.
I think it's probably, maybe it's just, yeah.
I think that's a permanent feature of the location. And if you look at the doorway and you think back to when Anne has been left in Arrested Development, she's been left there in Mexico, I think it's the same building. Like, if you look at it, and it's a building I've spotted in a few different LA productions, so I think it's this one location. Like, you could look at it. It's the same doorway.
Mm.
That's not just me, is it?
I think it's similar. Maybe, unless it's just one stereotypical design that they have. Or
could be,
one.
It could be. I don't know. It just looks the same to me.
It does look very similar.
Yeah.
Unless it's just...
the shape of the building's definitely the same. From another, front.
Yeah. It may be a movable
thing. I may be completely wrong. What I think happens, I think there is like this little area with a couple of little buildings in it. And they rent it out to Hollywood and TV productions, and they redress it to make it look like whatever they want to.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's one of the permanent features of this set, if I'm correct, because you did say it was shot in LA, so that seems to make sense.
Just north of LA, yeah. So there we go. This will be the. We're gonna start liking each other. Scene.
Yeah.
Wait.
Yeah, but they don't. The character redeems himself. He's learned a valuable lesson.
And this is the thing, right? In all these films, like they've only known each other about what, a day and a half, 2 days max.
Let's see, how many night times have there been?
One.
Yeah, I think there's only been two night times.
Two nights. The jungle.
So there's about 3 days left.
Yeah. So they've known each other for 3 days. As if anyone's gonna change that much in 3 days. But he sort of
and again, you sort of think it in the last scene as well. You think, oh no, they have made up, really.
Yeah, but they haven't.
But they haven't at all, like it, the way the film ends as well. And two at the both endings, as I said, there's two endings shot for this like last sequence that's coming up in a moment.
Yeah. So yeah, what was the? Did we talk about the fruit in the end?
The conlobus. No, I didn't actually get around to doing that, did I? I distracted myself. I think.
I like the score. The pig's right next to Hatch's.
So yeah, the conlobus, the fruit that's going to be used in this scene coming up as well. So it's still relevant. Is actually a fruit called. Right, this is where I have to pronounce something. I think this is why Guy got me to do this.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with Chirimoya, which is or the custard apple.
I like that.
As it's
the custard apple.
Known sort of its common term. The fruit doesn't cause paralysis at all. It's eaten all over the world, and it's basically known for its delicate flavour. Doesn't cause paralysis at all. Complete fabrication, but that's the fruit that's actually.
If they market it as a custard apple, I think it would do
custard
well.
Apple. People would buy it and probably be very disappointed because it's got a very delicate flavour. You're going to be expecting something rich, creamy, and sweet out of a custard apple.
Oh, what's this? Shit just got a little bit real.
Shit just got.
It's not going to be as real as the jungle.
It's not real. Shit just got elevated to happening. Shit just started happening. So we did talk about this, about what the plot for the sequel would have been if they brought it back. And I think what would have happened, it would have started off with Beck having his own restaurant.
Yeah.
And being called back to action, basically at the threat, probably of this guy. I think he'd have probably been a villain again. Or there'd have been another villain. Maybe this guy's boss or something. And it would have been, they come in and they destroy his restaurant.
Yeah.
And it then becomes, you know, you're going to do this. You're not allowed to leave the business. Sorry, you've got this to do. Go and do it. And then it becomes sort of like a revenge
for doing this to them.
Kind of plot, yeah.
You know, and for letting the son go. It's like, now you've got to get him back this time.
Yeah.
Or I'm going to fucking kill you.
That, or it's a case of that they both have to... It's obviously that they both have to team up again.
Yeah.
Somehow. Forcing them to work together in some kind of capacity or something. But you know it would have been the business being taken away from him at force, basically to result in the plot continuing. So yeah, you think they've sort of made up in the meantime, but
big seeds. I like that line. I don't like big seeds.
Big seeds. I don't like big seeds. Yeah.
There's some great little.
Lines that guy with the eyebrows there looks weirdly like someone I used to work with. Yeah. He wasn't as muscly, the guy, and he was a bit lanky, but same face. It's weird. They keep doing the wiggly shit with Rock's ears.
Yeah.
Like he's got hippo ears or something. Every time they cut to the Rock in that sort of mode, he's got wiggly ears going on.
Yeah,
and this is the bit they shot this two different ways. One time they go over to the car and they have a bit of an argument, and then they essentially drive off and continue to bicker as they drive away. I think they shot that first, and then they sort of had the idea that the thunder and lightning thing seemed to work so well, we're going to bring it back one more time. And I love the way this is shot, the way it builds up. You think it's going to be like one sort of last fight between them where he's finally going to try and take on the Rock or something like that, and the way it just completely subverts your expectation. It cuts away from it. It's the timing's perfect on it.
It's like the, you know, Marty McFly don't call me chicken thing, like pushed him one too many times.
Yeah.
Oh,
shit just got real.
Yeah, shit just got real.
The shit gets real, but not really. The shit's pretending to get real in this scene. But it's damned convincing.
Thunder.
it's the slow push in a moment on Sean William Scott as well. It really gives you a sense of something's building up. This shot.
Typical.
So, and the Sean music's William doing Scott. A good job of building it up as well. It's such a good fake out, this. And then we have Rhymefest, who play the film out. Awesome track called Run That.
get it. It's we've had this every time we, this comes
gets
on.
A lot of replays right now. It's a song of the moment. When sometimes Guy and I'll come across a song that we'll just play back to back loads and loads and loads. This has been the song recently to play loads.
Yeah, if you look, all these people were sort of
Vince McMahon is the owner of WWE.
Yeah, yeah, we'll cover a lot of these people. We're gonna have to do a little X-Pod and cover a lot of these crew members because I've got.
I'll leave talking about The Rock until then, I think, because there is a lot to talk about The Rock.
I didn't think we'd actually have this much to talk when we sat down and say, welcome to the jungle, how are we going to fill an hour and a half on this one? And now we've got two podcasts out of it. No, never has anyone gone into so much depth about Welcome to the Jungle.
Indeed.
Right, now, what's your shit ring for Welcome? Have you got anything else to say?
Nah, not for now. We'll save it for the X-Pod. So, for Welcome to the Jungle, then.
The shit rating.
I am going to go with a shit rating of 11%.
Oh! Snap, I put my fingers up to see what I was going to give him.
Wasn't looking at him. I genuinely wasn't even looking at Guy when
Boom.
I was doing it.
Snap!
11%, which I think is the same rating I gave Men in Black.
There you go.
So... Losing its points for like maybe some of the slightly dodgy special
CGI
effects
and like the story
and the
cut
and the yeah the slightly ropey storyline that's a bit forgettable, but in terms
really
of everything else works,
yeah,
and everything else works. Gangbusters. I mean, I've now watched this film
four
times in the past 2 months,
and it's not getting old.
Yeah, still like it.
Amazing comedy, amazing action, incredibly shot, lit, designed. Structured
soundtrack
just,
is soundtrack as well.
Great, it's just a fucking excellent film.
It's a crying shame it didn't get a sequel.
Oh, it's one of those ones like
it should have made its money. It deserved to make its money.
This was another Rush Hour trilogy waiting to happen. Really,
it was, and it would have been such good fun. Yeah. But sad.
Such a shame.
Either way, it's still of a gem of a film. It'll exist forever and well worth purchasing. And looks damn good in terms of like high def and stuff. Like, if you want to purchase this on Blu-ray, I think it's not actually a bad buy.
Yeah.
You can only buy it in America though. At this stage, there's no UK release for it, but worth picking up. It's a region-free Blu-ray, people. So go and pick it up. Get your American import on.
You never know if they might bring it back if we. Well, they haven't given Dread a
sequel.
This will be
what make like we're gonna be like the Dread sequel thing. We're gonna flood Amazon with purchases of Welcome to the Jungle and The Rundown. It's gonna become number one on all the lists, and then the studio are gonna be like, you know what, we should do a sequel to that movie. And then the Dread sequel people can do the meme where like Rundown 2, and then there's the reveal shot of Urban looking disappointed.
Can they have not given Dread a sequel? My God. I think it has been blatantly proven that it will make its money if they just sort of... Just make a fucking sequel.
I mean, it's been pretty much on the top of the DVD list and Blu-ray list since it came out.
It's bizarre.
On Amazon, because of that campaign. It's always been in the top 100.
Bizarre. People want it. Make the
people
fucking
want
film.
It. It's not going to happen.
Even if
I
it doesn't make
it's
its money back instantly, it's clearly a Blu-ray seller.
Yeah.
And it'll clearly make its money back
don't
on
think it's gonna happen.
Home video.
Sadly, don't think it's going to happen. But, oh well.
I reckon it will eventually. It'll get
so that's before we talk about Dread.
Right. Okay. So yeah, if you want
to, do you want to do the Selly Gump this time?
Selly Gump. Right. So the Selly Gump is if you want to the Selly Gump.
The Selly Gump.
It's my new band.
Gump is a word that only this podcast uses.
Gump. Guff. We use quite a lot. I think a lot of people use guff though.
Guff. Yeah. Guff was used in Wayne's World and shit like that. Yeah. But like gump is something that I don't think is used elsewhere.
Yeah. I mean, if you want to follow us on Twitter, you can follow us at Expositionist. Our main website is on the Badgerman network. It's badgerman.net/Expositionist. If you just hit up badgerman.net, you'll get all the other crap that's on there. he's saying that guy's just selling his own stuff really badly. No, but the main thing we got is Expositionist on badgerman.net/Expositionist, and you can get all our reviews, all the commentaries, all the original X-Pods. There's some other things on there. Loads of good stuff. Facebook, if you search for us on Facebook, it's just Expositionist. I think it's facebook.com/Expositionist.
Yep.
That's a good place to like us because we do a lot of stuff on that feed. All our commentaries go up there, so get notifications on that.
If you want to know what's happening and when, that's the
and you can generally and when we're doing research, we always bung stuff up. We got all sorts of good stuff. It's actually a little good. I mean, we try and do a film feed with a difference because everyone does the You know, like yesterday they announced they're going to bring back Twin Peaks, or you know.
So yeah, we don't really do the news so much anymore. We did at one stage, but we don't really do that anymore.
Everyone does that, and it's like I saw it about 10 different times, and like on my timeline it came up Twin Peaks, you know. So then I posted up a trailer for Bulletproof Monk, and you know, that sort of thing. So yeah, no, it, you know, all that sort of thing. What else we got? If you've got any comments, you can email us at expositionist@hotmail.com for emailing us. And we're also on iTunes. Search for Commentaries and Expod.
Or Expositionist works as well.
Expositionist works as well. I'm sure. Yeah, you know, we're around.
Yeah, I'll get your free con. Yeah. No mention of AC/DC there at all.
We're all over the internet. We're all over that shit.
We are. We are the internet.
We are the internet. We're like a bad
rash.
That's
a big statement.
Sort of hanging around the internet's genitals. Just won't go away.
So until next week's commentary, which will be the Addams Family, I've been Neil.
And I have been Guy.
Goodbye.
Oh, look, we timed it really
perfectly. We actually got it in before the credits finished.
Look at this.
That's amazing. That hasn't happened since, like, the first couple. Like, we always overrun.
Any similarity to actual persons living or dead? Oh, The Rock looks like my nan.
The Rock is my nan.